welcome one more time to Cricket Conversations with me, Rajaraman, and Hemant Kekre, my dear friend. Always good to be back talking cricket with Hemant. Hemant, today is a very special day in history of Indian cricket. India won the World Cup for the first time in 1983 on June 25 at Lord's. So let us try and recall what the World Cup means to you and to me, and see if it makes any sense to even talk about whether the World Cup changed the face of Indian cricket.
Changing the face of Indian cricket, there is absolutely no doubt that this was the second phase, if I may put it that way, from a change perspective as far as Indian cricket is concerned. The first one is something we have both discussed earlier, you know, when we spoke about the 1971 great wins, you know, one at Port of Spain in West Indies, and Trinidad, and the other one at Oval in England. But I think, of course, 1983, the world of cricket had completely changed. As we know, 74, around that time, was the time when one-day cricket came into being purely by accident. And then one-day cricket obviously caught the fancy of a lot of cricket lovers. And, you know, then one-day cricket was something which, unfortunately, India had never really made its mark as compared to the other countries. Like, for example, you have England and you had West Indies. You had New Zealand also, to a certain extent, and Australia. So 83 win at Lord's, 25th of June, which is today, was a fantastic, second landmark, if I may put it, big landmark, big chap, if I may put it that way, on Indian cricket.
Before 1983, in six World Cup games, India had only one game against East Africa. I mean, yes. we don't even know whether East Africa showed any interest in playing cricket after that World Cup. True. It was the only win that India got. And then India got beaten by Sri Lanka, which was still an associate member in 1979. So, Indians and limited over cricket were kind of far removed. It took us a long time to understand the nuances of one-day cricket. And I think the advent of a young Kapil Dev and his becoming captain not very long after, inside 4 years, I think it helped change the attitude toward one-day cricket. But I think there were a lot of all-rounders in that side. Many of them from Bombay, many of them from the northern parts of the country. It was perhaps the most balanced of teams back in 1983.
Yeah, and you know, if you look back from the time that one-day cricket started in 1974 until the time that India won the World Cup, the Cricket World Cup Prudential Trophy, as it was called in 1983, you know, there was a lot of changes because I was at that point in time growing up playing my little bit of office club cricket in Bombay. Bombay in those days. And, you know, I mean, as a fly on the wall, you know, there was so much of, resistance to playing one-day cricket, which particularly came from the earlier generation, you know, people who had played earlier. I don't want to name anybody, but there was a lot of some kind of a resistance. And we also know that a lot of people like Virat Kohli in Australia also didn't really like this whole thing called pajama cricket. And, of course, fueled by the whole Packer cases and all. So there was that little bit of a, you know, oh my God, you know, one-day cricket is not the cricket. Like, you know, today, the cricket romantics of 2020, you know, keep on saying that T20 is not the cricket and test cricket is the cricket. So there was obviously that little bit of a, you know, stigma, if I may put it that way, or resistance to one-day cricket, number one. Number two is the shift from, you know, long format cricket to test cricket, you know, was earlier seen in England with the Gillette Cup, for example. Though I must confess that there was one tournament in Bombay in those days, called the Talib Trophy, which was held even, I think, before Gillette took place, or rather was formed. And that is, I believe, still played in a 50-over format. So, apart from one or two places where, you know, people played limited-over cricket, there wasn't really, you know, kind of a movement that limited-over cricket had in India, which is the reason why India obviously didn't take it too seriously. Having said that, I think, of course, the whole 1983, the way that we look at it, the first win, if I may put it that way, against West Indies in the league games, was what actually, I would say, in a way, gave people, suddenly people, you know, got up and took notice and say, hey, you know what, these guys, you know, you can't take them lightly. And I think before that, I think the win, if I'm not mistaken, it was at Burpees, if I'm not mistaken, just before the 1983 World Cup, or when the team under, again, Kapil Dev toward the West Indies, and they had beaten the West Indies in West Indies. And I think that also sort of must have given Kapil and the team a lot of confidence saying that we can beat them. Not just beat them, but beat England. And beat Australia. It's not just beating the West Indies, which really matters. Because England also was a very formidable one-day team. So was Australia.
We might not remember a date. We might not remember the game. But there is one thing that really sticks to memory. Apart from the final, of course. One thing that sticks to memory is Kapil Dev 175.
Oh, yes.
Curiously, none of us saw that innings because it was not on television for whatever reason. And then, but we all remember that innings like we ourselves saw it. Thanks to a few journalists who were there, and I think thanks to some radio commentary that we got to hear, the impact of Kapil Dev's innings and then whatever we heard later. I remember Sunil Gavaskar telling the world that when Kapil Dev came in at lunchtime, he was batting at lunchtime, and there used to be the concept of lunch in a 60-over game. When he came in for lunch, the whole Indian team had left the dressing room just to Kapil Dev. There was just a glass of water placed on the table next to Kapil Dev's seat so that he could calm down. He would have been very angry at 17 for 5. But he played perhaps the most defining knock in Indian cricket history as far as limited over cricket is concerned. It was perhaps the most significant of knocks played very early on. What are your own thoughts on that 175? I know you were in England at that point of time. Were you by any chance near Tunbridge Wells?
It's a very funny story. I was playing club cricket in England in North Middlesex League. And that day happened to be an odd day, not a Saturday or a Sunday, so there were no games. And I remember the late Arvind Apte, who also is a former India, was a former India cricketer. And, you know, he's a complete, an Englishman to the core in that sense. He really loved everything English and, spent every summer in England till he passed away. And he called me a couple of days before the game and said, why don't we go to Tunbridge Wells and watch the game? And I said, wow, why not? You know, because it'll be easier to get tickets and all that, not really a big problem because it was a smaller city. And we decided to meet at a certain railway station, which was very close to Lord's. He used to live exactly opposite Lord's in those days. And, you know, he said, well, why don't you meet me at St. John's Wood or one of the stations close by? And when I reached there, I gave him a call. He said, India's in trouble. There are 3 wickets down. You know, do you think it's really worth, going all the way? And why don't you come home? You know, let's have a meal and let's talk about, cricket and etc. So, I mean, it's unfortunate that both Arvind Uncle and I, had planned and, it was that the sandwiches were packed so that you don't have any kind of trouble. But we missed it, unfortunately. But what a knock that was. I mean, I remember after that game, speaking to a couple of the Bombay cricketers. I mean, I'm saying Bombay because it was Bombay in those days, with whom I had the fortune, very good fortune of playing club and office cricket with. And I'm talking about people like Sandeep Patil, Balwinder Sandhu, Ravi Shastri, Dilip Vengsarkar, and of course, Sunil Gavaskar. And a lot of them, were just raving about that. They said, he really took the Zimbabwean bowling by the cuff. And, and nobody would have expected, the kind of turnaround that India did. And, people forget Syed Kirmani. I mean, people talk about 175, but you need somebody at the other end and somebody to give him that kind of confidence. So, Kiri, as I've always called him very, very fondly, he's a lovely human being. And I think Kirmani's, contribution to Kapil Dev, I would say, is a lot more than what people like today. I mean, you read the newspapers, everybody's talking about 175 Kapil Dev, which is obviously there. I mean, it should be spoken about. It should be in letters of gold. But people do tend to, miss the gentleman called Syed Mujtaba Hussain Kirmani, who also played that stellar role in helping Kapil to, cross the barrier of 250 odd runs, which eventually they did. And then, won the game. And that was the game where actually, I must have given the entire team, the kind of feeling that, listen, we can't let our captain down. I mean, and that's precisely why everybody must have kept that, glass of water, which is a story even I'd heard, that, kept on the glass and walked out, which is the right thing to do, in a situation like that. Because Kapil, obviously must be fuming when he came in at lunch. Because, this is the beauty of these genius cricketers. I've had the fortune of playing with a few geniuses, at a club level, of course, I mean, not at a senior level. And the difference between us and them is huge. I mean, like, huge. It's like that song of Pink Floyd, us and them, And it's completely different. So I can imagine, for them, a grassy wicket, a green top, a bouncy wicket, they play their natural game. And because that's why they are geniuses, and that's what being a genius is all about. And that's what being Kapil Dev is all about. So, Kirmani to be remembered, that's what I always tell people, please don't forget him. And of course, the turnaround that India did post that game at Tunbridge Wells.
Dada, you spoke about Kirmani. Let us try and listen into what Kapil Dev himself has to say about Kirmani and that the valuable contribution that Kirmani had. Also, Madan Lal and Roger Binney, if I remember right.
Yes.
And perhaps even Balwinder Sandhu. Everybody yes. contributed to keeping Kapil Dev's morale high.
I remember Kirmani said to me, middle of the inning. If we are taking run, if a chance of run out, I'll throw my wicket. So you, whichever side you are, you have to take. So those type of things start happening in the team, which was unheard before that. It was, let's put it that way. And so many other stories we come to know also before that. He made his run out in this. That's where, I would say, that's where the team spirit of playing was one word when he said that.
I think once the 200 mark was passed, Phil Dev just flowed like the river. Played perhaps one of the, and I get goosebumps as I'm talking about it.
That's absolutely.
Greatest innings. We have seen a double 100 from Rohit Sharma, from Sachin Tendulkar. We've seen Mahendra Singh Dhoni play a 183 in Vishakhapatnam. He's had some fabulous knocks too. But I think that 175 not out perhaps is the most defining of innings. I can't think of what would have happened to India's one-day cricket but for that innings. India had lost to Zimbabwe that game. I think it was out of the World Cup. After that, it went to Australia, England and West Indies in successive matches. I think India team was on a roll. I think one person who missed out though on a lot of cricket in the World Cup was Dilip Vengsarkar because of an injury.
Yes, the second game against the West Indies, correct.
I think it was a fabulous team. I think they believed in each other no matter what the world had to tell about a former captain and a current captain in the side and having a musical chair. But I think they all gelled wonderfully well and they understood what they needed to do on a given day and then went on to win so many games and the World Cup.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So did you get to manage to watch the final event? Were you able to get to Lords at all?
Well, I got to Lords. The day was a Sunday and the day was a very crucial game that I was playing for my club, which is North Middlesex League, and it was a very crucial game. And there was no way that any one of us, or at least I, being the only Indian playing for that club, had any kind of guts to ask my management of my team, think, can I please go to the World Cup? But I did manage to, hop into the Westmoreland Hotel the night before the game, the night before the final. And I remember meeting a couple of my Bombay club and office mates there. I remember meeting Ravi, I remember meeting Ballu, as I call him, Ballu Sandhu, with whom I've actually grown up playing cricket. I mean, he's one of my favorite cricketers. He's always been a brilliant, not just a brilliant bowler, batsman and a thinker, but also a wonderful human being. So I played a lot of cricket and I just wanted to go across and wish them well. So obviously wish Sunil, my cousin, all the best. And, he's one of those early early to bed guys. So he wasn't there, when I met Ballu and Ravi, and we were talking about the composition of the team. And I remember Ravi saying that, tomorrow's another day. And I don't think we should talk about tomorrow. Let's enjoy ourselves and let's just, chill and relax. I mean, that was the kind of attitude that they had. So I realized today, much later, that, the way that the team was preparing for the World Cup, for the final, was, there were no, we've seen a lot of times, a lot of Indian teams, men and women, of late in the last couple of years, reaching the final of a particular championship, maybe I would talk about the Champions Trophy to be a prime example, Or you can talk about the Women's World Cup, which happened, the T20 World Cup happened in Australia last year. And it looked like we were there, but we did not cross the line. And I guess one of the reasons could be, and I'm just, just guessing, I could be that, the nerves can get the better of you, And I think there, that was the difference because they were really looking chilled. And they were all so chilled, they were so relaxed. And, it looked like, there wasn't a care in the world, considering the fact that they're going to play all these big guys like the Joel Garners of the world, the Michael Holdings, and the big cat, Clive Lloyd, Vivian Richards, Gordon Binney. They were big names, huge names in one day cricket. Not just names, but they were names which are phenomenal. But the way that the Indian team looked to me that the evening before the game, they looked relaxed, they looked chilled. Having said that, unfortunately, by the time my game finished, I tried my best to come to Lords. I did manage to get to Lords. I managed to get inside, the wall, the grace gates or whatever. And there was no way because I think it was around the same time that the last two or three wickets, fell. And I was trying to make my way in with my cricket kit. And, it so happened that the crowds were ridiculous. One couldn't imagine because, when I left my club, India were all out for 183. So it was, none of us really expected, you know, them to come back the way they did. I mean, of course, all of us hope that, you know, miracle will happen. But I guess that one pull which the master, Viv Richards, played, and that brilliant catch by Kapil Dev, and that change of pace or deceit, if I may put it that way, by Madipa, Madan Lal, you know, turned the game, you know, on its head completely. And then, of course, the kind of bowling that you rightly said, you know, Roger Binney, Ballu, Balwinder Sandhu, those two wickets, I mean, that, you know, the way that, you know, he got Gordon Edge out. And of course, the chipping in by the fielders. Nobody talks about the fielding. The Indian team fielding was brilliant. It was never an Indian hallmark in the past. So I think it was a combination of everything. But unfortunately, well, I can tell you one thing. I caught the atmosphere. I didn't catch the game. So that's good enough for me.
Two very strong memories from that game. I used to work with a Hindu in Madras, and I was on the desk. So I was on night duty that day. And so I did get some updates as the game was progressing. And we had a television in the sports editor's room. So we went and watched the game. Between editions, we could go and watch the game. I remember Srikant's square drive of Andy Roberts. He was down on his right knee. And
one knee.
I don't think I will ever forget that shot in my life.
Never.
There are very few strokes that you remember. Everyone talks about Dhoni's helicopter six in the 2011 World Cup. I think Srikant's square drive of Andy Roberts is an outstanding memory. I don't think I will ever be able to even forget that. The other one was Balwinder Sandhu bowling Gordon Greenidge. Greenidge shouldering arm,
yes.
Watching with consternation, we often being disturbed. A lot of people talk about Kapil Dev's catch. I had not watched it that day because I think there was a glitch in the satellite communication at that point of time. And not very many of us could watch Kapil Dev's catch. But I knew that he'd taken a fabulous catch when I read Armohan's report in the Hindu. He was writing for the Hindu, and I was one of the first people to read his report. But these two memories, one of Srikant and another of Balwinder Sandhu. And then I remember Mohinder Amarnath getting holding out LBW, running toward the pavilion, and on the way he wanted to pluck a stump out as a souvenir and failed to do that. I have watched the clip a number of times, and I can't for the life of me imagine how Jimmy Pa forgot, how he was not able to latch onto the stump and pluck it out of the ground. He ran for safety towards the pavilion, but missed out on picking up a stump on the way. That is something that I can never forget as well. You must have your own memories from that game.
Absolutely. I mean, see, I actually saw the English, rather the West Indian batting, rather the Indian batting. So I didn't unfortunately get to see the first half of the more important half of the, including the great cash taken by Kapil Paji. So I missed that because I was en route from my club to the ground. And by the time I reached, it was too late. But having said that, I think watching the game later, which you watched immediately after the game, you know, the highlights were on and they just kept on and on and on. I mean, number one, people couldn't believe that the Indians had beaten the West Indies, because there was this huge thing about West Indians in England in those days. I mean, a lot of clubs, so for example, a lot of counties were populated by West Indian players of, you know, from various islands, you know, Barbadians, Bajans, the Trinidadians, the Jamaicans. And, you know, it was amazing to see, you know, the Indians sort of, you know, come on top. And I think there was a lot of sense of, what shall I say? I mean, you know, obviously the English were disappointed because, you know, they lost to India in the semifinals. And I remember that game also, I watched it actually live on TV. And along with me were two total romantics of Indian and world cricket. One obviously was Arvind after, the other one was the late Raj Singh Dungadpur. And we watched that game. And I remember Rajbhai, you know, squealing like a child, you know, whenever, you know, India was, you know, anywhere like getting, you know, either somebody who scored a boundary or the way that we got England out. And I remember him, you know, sort of getting up when England was dismissed. I don't remember the exact score. And somebody said that, you know, is that score enough for India? Or is it too much? And he said, nay, nay, you know, we have it. So, you know, that all those small memories of being there and being with people who, you know, followed cricket like it was their life. And that's what people like Arvind Uncle and Rajbhai did all their lives. You know, I mean, it was amazing to see them, you know, squeal like little children, you know. And it was amazing. And even I think the win against Australia was the crucial one where, you know, people then realized that, oh, you know, these guys really can't be, you know, the Englishmen also realized that these are not the kind of guys we can take really lightly. I know I've read somewhere about some comments made by the English media at that point in time, oh, no, playing India is a cakewalk, etc., etc. And I was given to understand later that people like Sandeep Patil, Sandy as we call him, and people like Yashpal Sharma, what an innings he played, I remember. You know, they actually, you know, took that to heart. Very, very, very similar to what had happened in 76 when Tony Gregg, you know, spoke about the West Indians and trying to make them grovel. So I think that really stayed at the back of the mind of all these, these wonderful people. And that's when we won. And I think that, I think the memory was not just that final. I think the memory was the entire progress. I remember Mr. Gavaskar, Sunil Gavaskar being dropped for a couple of games, and Rohan Kanai, you know, speaking in the English media and saying, how can you drop Sunil Gavaskar? All these small things. Dilip Vengsarkar being injured and unfortunately not being able to play a lot of cricket after that, including the finals. And I think Dilip and Ravi, I mean, because at that point in time, you know, we were, Dilip and I, you know, he was my senior in the House of Tatas, where I played, which I represented. And, you know, it was really sad to see these people not there. But, you know, at the end of the day, it didn't really matter who played and who didn't. I mean, all that entire squad, including the one cricketer who didn't play any game, Sunil Walson, must be feeling so happy and so proud that they were part of that magical team, you know, which redefined, cricket, not just one day cricket, but cricket in India. That we could beat anybody, be it the mighty West Indies or anybody. You know, that I think was very important.
You talked about Sunil Walson. I was privileged to work with him for 2 years when we were both with part of the Delhi Daredevils support staff. He was a manager of the side, an assistant manager of the side, and I was the media manager. So I got to spend a lot of time with Sunil Walson. Very happy to tell you, Dada, that in 2 years, I never heard him once complain that he didn't get a single game in the World Cup. I think he was happy to be a part of the squad that went from strength to strength. And I think that is what that one instance tells me, how strong the team was, how strongly united it was. They might have had differences of opinion outside of the cricket ground. They might have been from the north and from the west. But I think they all came together as one strong unit and performed their own roles. Each one of them delivered their best. And then we got to see India with the World Cup. I know it is a little 2011, when India won the World Cup again under Mahendra Singh Dhoni, especially at home, the pressures were very different. But as final, I think Kapil Dev and his team, they called it the devil. I would rather stick to Kapil Dev and his team. The Indian side of 1983, the class of 1983, were pioneers and set the ball rolling for one day cricket to take ground in India. We got to see a lot of wonderful players emerge from there. A lot of others were inspired by 1983. I know, for instance, Sachin Tendulkar has gone on record several times as saying that 1983 ensured that he would become a cricketer. I'm sure Rahul Dravid and Saurav Ganguly were also inspired by what happened in 1983. A lot of us felt the impact. And I think we continue to see the effect of 1983 on not just on Indian cricket, Dada, but on Indian sport. Around the time that the World Cup happened, we also saw colour television come into India. And yes, it was the first big conquest that we got to see on television. An Indian team travelling outside and winning matches, then coming home with the World Cup, getting to meet the Prime Minister and the President, and then Lata Mangeshkar singing that song at Indira Gandhi Stadium to raise some money for the team. You got to see 1983 as perhaps one of the most significant milestones in Indian cricket history.
Absolutely. And also don't forget the kind of impact that particular victory made to the diaspora, which was in England. They had, you know, a lot of them had come, the Indian origin, people from Uganda, you know, those who were displaced by autocratic governments or dictator-led governments. They were working very, very hard. You know, they were really working, you know, their backs out to sort of make a mark. What we see today, the number of, you know, millionaires and people, are, you know, and I remember, you know, the person who used to host me, a gentleman called Mahendra Bhai Amin, they were so happy because, you know, there was always that little colonial hang-up which all of them had, because a lot of them were sort of probably from the colonial era, born during the colonial era or just after, you know. So them also, you know, India beating the West Indies and winning the World Cup, it doesn't matter whom they beat. And obviously, they beat the top three. They beat West Indies twice in the game. They beat Australia. They beat England. These were the top three teams. Beating them, and you know, they actually gave the local diaspora in England, and I'm sure in the US as well, some kind of a feeling that, you know, you know, don't take us lightly. You know, we're not somebody you can just shake off and say, oh, you know, these guys, you know, they can't play cricket. Or, you know, I remember that silly joke that used to happen every time, you know, whenever we played, whenever we went to England in the 80s. I mean, this victory, to me as an outsider, like an Indian going into England, and also to the local English Indians, like they're all English and they're all Indian origin. So they're all Englishmen of Indian origin, you know, the kind of pride that they got. And I actually saw it. You know, I can assure you, Raj, after the World Cup, I was there for a short time because I was playing for a long time, actually, a month and a half, too. There was a swag in every Indian at that point in time. It was good to see them walk at Leicester Square or Piccadilly Circus or, you know, Oxford Street with that, you know, that swag, you know, which the West Indians used to have. So it was good to see that. So it's not just the young talent like Sachin and Rahul and all were sort of impacted. The impact went beyond just cricketers. It also went to Indians as businessmen, as entrepreneurs. And as we can see, you know, almost 30-odd years after that, you can see the way that the Indians have, you know, made their mark and, you know, established themselves in the old life. You know?
There were a couple of things that I know happened. One is that NKP Salve did not get enough tickets for the game. And then he brought the 1987 World Cup to India. He called it the Reliance Cup.
Yes. Yes.
And I think that set the ball rolling also for a changeover in administrative structure of the ICC. England and Australia used to dominate, and I think at some point of time the South Africans were also as strong. But eventually, to pull the rug from under England and Australia's feet, NKP Salve had to be slighted with fewer tickets than he won in 1983.
Absolutely.
I think a lot of us tend to gloss over the fact that it is not just in the cricketing front, but also on the administration and governance front.
Yes,
changes happened. The other thing that I remember very strongly about what 1983 did is the fact that a lot of us started believing in ourselves. I think the man on the street started believing in himself. Then when I went to England in 1999 for the next World Cup that was held there, after 16 years, I got to see the Indians behave in a very different fashion in 1999. They were boisterous. They introduced a whole new concept of spectating to England. And we got to see the World Cup in 1999 being perhaps one of the noisiest that England has ever hosted. And the Indian diaspora there can claim credit for that. They found their voice. I think that is what Kapil Dev's team has done to a lot of young Indians who are growing up in 1999.
And apart from that, I mean, you can see all over the world. It's not just in India. And people also forget the famous 1985-86 BNH win that, you know, was the team led by Sunil Gavaskar. So I think it started that era. I think the game that we beat West Indies in the Caribbean just before the 1983 World Cup was the start of that glorious era of one-day cricket, which, you know, sort of, you know, just went down from 1983 to 1984-85-86. And then that magnificent win at Sharjah, again, under the captaincy of Kapil Dev. If I mistake not, then India was bundled out for around 100 odd and got the Pakistan team, you know, a strong Pakistan team, you know, virtually destroyed them. So I think that era was brilliant. I mean, it just sort of, you know, it's like on the piggybacking on the 1983 World Cup, I don't think we really looked back. Because after that, we realized that whenever there was a tri-series in Australia, India may not have won it, but India was never ever taken lightly. I mean, never ever taken lightly after that, because you never knew, you know, what kind of spirit or what kind of Josh, if I put it that way, the Indians would show. So earlier, it was just a cakewalk, like the English media, I mean, a few people in the English media before the 83 semi-final said, oh, you know, England's a cakewalk and we need to mentally prepare for the West Indians. And that's not going to happen anymore. And that I think is a big achievement, you know, today Kapil Paji and the entire team should feel very proud about.
As a sports journalist, I may not sound the best when I say I'm grateful, but these are moments that we live for as journalists, as fans. I think we live for these moments. And those who are privileged to watch it at Lord's for in flesh and blood, they're very fortunate. Not just privileged, but fortunate as well. And they live to tell the story. So many of them are around and they have told us some wonderful stories from 1983. It does stay with us for a long time. I don't think memories like this can be erased very much. Very
never,
easy.
Never.
Very easy. We might have seen a lot of victories. We might have seen a lot of epochal games being played. I think that 1983 has embedded in the minds of all those who watched and all those who didn't watch. I think a lot of us might not have had the privilege of watching the game back in 1983, but it is embedded in our mind thanks to YouTube now. We get to see some clips. We have seen Kapil Dev's catch maybe millions of times because it is perhaps one of the, again, a defining moment in the game, apart from the Greeny dismissal, of course, Vivian Richard. And then Clive Lloyd not contributing at all. I think there were lots of significant moments like that. Wonderful memories, and so glad to be able to relive some of those with you today. Thank you very much.
I think it's been a pleasure, and I think every moment of that game, it's not just one particular vignette that you remember, like you mentioned the fantastic cover drive by Srikant or that catch taken by Paji, or you know, even a catch, the simple catch that Roger Binney took off by Roy, for example. You know, one can't forget that. I mean, to me, every ball, and it's like that golden era film. You know, you can watch it a million times and you're never satiated. You always get to know something new in it. You know, so I think that's what is to me that win is all about. So I think it's you know, it always makes you misty, but it makes you misty with a lot of pride. Really enjoy going back into the old days, and whatever little memories that we have, you know, we're more than happy to sort of share it with you. So feedback is always welcome. Your thoughts are always welcome. Thank you so much, Raj. And thank you, everybody.